Hello friends, and welcome back to the Tom Photo channel. And of course, welcome new viewers. Today, I'd like to tell you how to use RawTherapee to quickly convert raw images into beautiful JPEGs, such as these showing in the background. I'm gonna skip a lot of details, and sometimes I don't even mention them. And I'll only show the settings that matter the most to get to the point immediately. This is because I wanna get you started quickly, and I don't want you to get lost in it. I intend to post more thorough and advanced user videos in the future. So for today's exercise, I intentionally took a difficult picture this morning, this one. You see the shadows don't have a lot of detail and the light part of the sky is a bit washed out. Also, the cloud isn't nearly as dramatic as it should be. I'm not even talking about the composition here, this could also use a touch. Alright, let's fire up RawTherapee and see what it can do for us. The image is going to appear in the middle of the screen here, and you see that it's surrounded by a lot of information that, you know, things that you can change, and it can get really confusing. I'm gonna try to break it down for you and try to keep it simple. I'm using Linux, by the way, here. It doesn't matter, you can use Mac or Windows. RawTherapee is gonna work equally well. It might be that the appearance of the user interface is gonna be slightly different. But the things that matter are the 7 tabs here on the right. So under these tabs, you have all the parameters that you can change when you alter the image. And as you can see, you have so many of them. So let's see what the essential ones are. So today I'm going to talk about the tab number 1, which is the exposure settings, tab number 2, which is the sharpening settings, tab number 3 is the color aspects of the image, and number 5 is the shape and size. So I'm only going to show you the most important parameters that you want to change. So starting from number 1, the exposure settings, the first stop I would make is at the exposure compensation. So you can increase or decrease the compensation. And this is the prime place where you want to make changes if your image is too dark or too light. Okay, number 2, I would basically skip over all of these to save you some time. And think about dodging and burning aspects. So these are shadows and highlights that you can now change. Okay, to make this section active and to make the changes actually take effect, you have to click this little circle. And now every change that you make is going to influence the image. So let's turn the highlights up like this, perhaps all the way to like 65 or so. And you see how the sky now turned much darker, and the image now looks much less washed out. And the shadows are a little bit too dark as well. So we'll turn the shadows to the right like so. We don't wanna go too far because otherwise we're gonna lose all the drama. All right, so I would leave the tonal width settings the way they are as a beginner and maybe not touch them right now. So next thing is tone mapping. This is one of the key things that you can change. You make this active. With the default setting, it became really detailed, as you can see. You can see everything here. The field is very, very detailed now. For my taste, it is too much so. I think although we can see everything, the drama is kind of gone. So I'm gonna turn this down to the minimum, 0.01. And to see what kind of effect it took, let me toggle between the tone mapping on and off so you can see it. See that? This is the effect that we're getting. Okay, this seems about right. The image isn't bad. The image is really, really already getting much better. Okay, and the last thing under this tab I want to show you is the graduated filter. This is the perfect way to bring back the sky. Let's activate this. All right, and when you click this round button here, you get like a cross-looking thing, And as you move this around, you can make everything above it darker, and nothing below it is going to get darker. So, and you're gonna have a nice gradient, so you're not gonna have very strong lines. Alright, so let me toggle on and off so you can see it a little bit better. So on, I'm sorry, this is off, this is on, this is off, this is on. You see how it makes the sky so much nicer. And if you want to give it more weight to make the sky even darker, you just increase the strength. Let me just increase it all the way. See that? Now you almost have, now you have a storm sky right before the storm. Well, it's a little bit too much for us, so let's go back to, like, I don't know, 65 perhaps? Seems a bit... Well, yeah, 65 is good. So, I like this image a lot already, and we're actually done with the first tab. Simple as that. Going to the second tab, which is sharpening. We definitely want to sharpen it. Let's activate the sharpening. Two things you want to keep in mind when sharpening images. I would always recommend sharpening the edges only. So click this edges only and make sure that it actually doesn't touch the really, really light edges. You want to turn the threshold to the right a little bit, like so. Now it really looks looks natural when you take a closer look. And you can always take a closer look by just using your mouth and zooming in and seeing if it is sharp enough. And I think for my taste it is. I kind of like it. So next one under this is local contrast. So I would never use global contrast on any picture, but local contrast is really a very powerful tool. It doesn't ruin your picture, but it gives it much more detail. Let me turn on the local contrast. See, this is with a default setting, and this is obviously a little bit too much, you know, on and off. It's a little bit too dramatic. So we're gonna reduce the amount. The only thing that I would touch here as a beginner is the amount. And let's go down to like 0.05. And you see that, you know, that looks really good. The drama is there and the details are not gone, so I like this. Edges wouldn't touch, micro contrast wouldn't touch. Now the next big question to solve is the noise reduction. The image is a little bit too noisy. When you zoom in, you can see a little bit too much grain. See those little dots? We would like to get rid of this grain. And the two things that I always do is, first, I always activate the impulse noise reduction and also click the regular noise reduction. The regular noise reduction is not going to do anything unless you actually change the luminance slider here. So let's change that. With a normal photo, I would probably set it around 6 or so. This is going to lose some of the details, so you have to recover the details. Let's move the detail recovery slider, well, to about the same value, roughly 6. Now we have taken care of the noise. The picture is nice and smooth. Obviously, if you are using a lot of tone mapping under the first tab, then the picture is gonna get more grainy. In that case, you want to turn the luminance more to the right, perhaps all the way to 40 or even 50. But then you have to recover the details too by bringing the detail slider to the right. Okay, let's see what else is here. Skip all those, don't worry about those as a beginner, just don't think about them. Haze removal, very, very nice and powerful thing. You click this and see what happens. Oh wow, it just ruined your picture. And why? This is because you did not click the luminance only. By clicking the luminance only, it is not going to change the colors, it will just affect the luminance. And obviously this is, I mean, all the haze is gone, it's obvious, but the picture is unnatural. So we have to change the strength to a much smaller value. Haze removal in this picture is not important. I perhaps wouldn't use it, but if I use it, I probably give it the value of around 2 or so. Well, that looks pretty good. So let's remove some of the haze. Okay, and we're done with the second tab. We just changed a couple of parameters here, so I hope you appreciate how simple it became. The third tab, the first thing to do is to change the temperature of the image. If it's too cold or too warm, you can change it. The roughly 6700 works really well here. I like it a lot. So I don't want to change it, but let's just do it so that you can see what happens. If you turn it to the left, it becomes much colder. You turn it to the right, it becomes much warmer. It's almost like a sunset now. Okay. So let's go back to 6700, which is really good. Another thing to do is if you want to give your image more color, here's the place to do it. Do it under the Vibrance. You have a lot of other options there as well, but they don't work as well. Click Vibrance, change the value, it becomes much more vibrant, you know, as vibrant as you want to make it. I'm not a huge fan of colors, you know, terribly intense colors for this particular photograph, so I'm gonna go with Vibrance value of, no, perhaps 2, no more than that. Okay, change. Don't pay attention to any of these. Soft light, that is a really good way to make your image more contrasty as well. You click this and see what happens. I'm gonna toggle it on and off with the default settings, and the front of the image is becoming darker with the soft light on, and oftentimes it works really well, but not so much for this photograph. Because we worked so hard to make this field visible, we don't want to destroy it. So let's not today use soft light, but just remember that it's a really nice tool to use. Color toning, that's where I would correct most of the colors. That's how I do it. You click it on, you toggle it on, and then you slide this white point like so to see if there's something you like, and if you like it, you just leave it at that, and it's gonna take effect. All right, if anything, I would perhaps give it a little bit more orange, like that, to make the sky a little bit more orange looking. So we're just gonna slide this white point a little bit to the northeast. All right, what else? And we're also done with the color. So the image basically looks really good now. What is left is tab number 5, as I mentioned. This is the shape and size of the image. Two very important things here, actually 3. Go all the way to the bottom and then slightly back up where you see distortion correction. Click this automatic button. This is going to automatically get rid of a lot of the lens distortion that you have. You can get more fancy, but always try this automatic first. And right now it's not doing anything because it does not need to be corrected, but basically just try this automatic first. And the second thing up here is if your image is not perfectly level, if the horizon is not perfectly level, you can, under rotate, you can change this slider and rotate this image. Right now the, let me just show you how it works too. So you can change this slider, turn it, or pull it left or right, and so the image is going to turn like that. We don't have to do this, so we'll go back to 0. Images that don't have perfectly level horizon look pretty terrible to me, so that's something that I always try to do. And up here is crop. Let's go to crop. and yeah, turn this on. We need to crop this image to make it a little bit nicer, like so. Go back down like that, and that looks really good. Well, perhaps down a little bit more to take care of the composition a little bit more. I actually like it even lower than that. Okay, so here's a good composition. All right, and now that we're done with our image, we can save it as a TIFF file. And we can also save it as a JPEG, but the reason I'm saving it as a TIFF file is that I usually also want to make some changes using GIMP, and TIFF file is much better for that. It will contain more information. So to do that, you press Control S, and this will open a new window. And there you can choose whether you want the TIFF or a JPEG. Today I'm selecting 16-bit TIFF, and I click OK. Okay, the image has been saved, and let's go to the folder to take a look at what we have. And here it is. You see that it appears as a TIFF file, and also here's our original RAW file, and these PP3 files are RawTherapee files. This is the settings that we used to convert these images. And let's go and open the TIFF file with GIMP to see what it looks like. All right. These are large files. They take a long time. And my computer is not that great. But here's the image. And finally, before I sign off, I would like to show you side by side the original image, that the JPEG that came out of the camera, and then the image that we just created. And I hope you see that the new image is much nicer, and I also hope that you saw that it didn't take that much effort to make it so much nicer. Please let me know in the comments if you would like to learn more. I can always make more videos. I like it. I enjoy helping you, and I enjoy photography a lot. Thank you so much for tuning in to Tom Photo Channel. I hope to see you again soon in my other videos where I talk about photography related matters. Have a great day.